Hello, welcome back to my channel. My name is Brittany and this is my August wrap up. So if you guys have been watching my vlogs at all, you'll know that August has been one of the best rating months this year for me. You'll definitely see that when I get into the average rating for this month. I've just thoroughly enjoyed everything I picked up this month. There was nothing I disliked and everything actually got really high ratings because I finally just decided if I'm not loving something, let it go and pick up things that I'm really interested in. And it feels amazing. I don't know why I get bogged down sometimes by thinking like, okay, just because you said you were gonna read this, now you have to. And that's so silly because no one has time for that. So happy with all the books that I picked up in the month of August. Fingers crossed, September, October, November, December, next year will all be the same because my average rating from the beginning of the year kept going down and down and down. I just wasn't loving things as much. So it's good to see it go back up again. So in the month of August, I read a total of 8 books, which I'm really thrilled with because I thought I was gonna honestly read like 4 maybe, just with so many trips out of town, being on vacation, having less time. So I'm thrilled with 8 things. 5 of these were audiobooks though, and only 3 were physical books, but that is because the physical books I picked up are super big books, so they took a long time to read, and that's totally fine. I really enjoyed the mix of audio versus physical books that I read this month, and I think it worked out perfectly. So 3 of these books were fantasy, 2 were sci-fi, 1 was a mystery, and 2 were horror. And actually all 8 books that I read in the month of August were adult books. So as far as pages read, I read a total of 4,308 pages. 1,974 pages were books that I listened to through audio, and 2,334 pages were books that I read physically. I had 1 3.5 star book, 2 4 star book, 1 4.5 star book, 3, possibly 3 4.75 star books, and 1 5 star book. The reason that I say possibly is because I haven't finished one of the books yet. I believe it's gonna be a 4.75, but I'm 80% in. It totally depends on the ending. As long as that book is a 4.75 out of 5 stars, that gives me an average rating for the month of 4.4, which is so good. Only in the month of March was my average rating higher, and a lot of the months were in the 3-star range for the average rating, so I'm super happy. So let's get into the books that I read this month. You guys know I like to do this by starting with my least favorite book of the month and then working my way towards my favorite book of the month. Now, as I said, my least favorite book is still a book I really enjoyed because I didn't dislike any books I read this month, but I like to put them in order. It makes it more fun for me. The first book that I read in the month of August is We Are Legion, which is book 1 in the Babaverse series by Dennis E. Taylor. This is an adult sci-fi series that's just a super fun time. I give this a 3.5 out of 5 stars. So as you can tell, I really enjoyed my time listening to this audiobook. So it begins with our main character basically dying. And when he wakes up, I don't want to say too much for spoilers. I don't think this would be spoilery. That first fact is in the synopsis. And he doesn't have a body anymore. So it's just his consciousness. And he is property of the state now and basically is sent on this mission. He has to go through these trials to determine if he's a good candidate for this task that they want him to accomplish. And he's sent on a mission to do that. But there's so much humor in this book. There's so many references. Geez, let me think. There's definitely Star Trek. Is it Star? I feel like there's Star Wars too. I don't feel like I'm making that up. And then The Simpsons. So yeah, definitely all 3 of those there's references to. And I just found myself laughing out loud the whole time. So while we're dealing with things like virtual reality and uploading consciousness and finding new planets, because that he's basically finding a place for the remaining humans to inhabit since they need to leave where we are now. So the plot is just very engaging, but the humor and the main character is what really did it for me. It's very sarcastic at times, and I liked it enough that I definitely want to continue on and pick up book 2. So I'm looking forward to doing that. I don't know when I'll pick it up just because I have so many things coming up in the near future, but I definitely look forward to continuing on with this series. And if you're looking for a fun sci-fi story that's just gonna give you a lot of laughs and be a great ride, then I recommend picking this book up. Next we have I, Robot by Isaac Asimov, and I gave this a 4 out of 5 stars. Once again, this is an adult sci-fi novel that I listened to the audiobook of it and I had a great time listening to it. This one is not quite as humorous as We Are Legion. Definitely a different tone. I highly recommend the audiobook of this as well. The narrator is just fantastic. But if you guys are familiar with the movie I, Robot with Will Smith, which I have always been a huge fan of, I absolutely love that movie. This is very, very, very different, but it's okay. It's different in a good way. They both are like their own separate things. There are times here and there that definitely made me reference like scenes in the movie, but for the most part, it's its own separate thing. But I really enjoy this because this explores the topic of human connection with artificial intelligence, but then also artificial intelligence becoming the dominant, I don't want to say species because that doesn't make sense, but becoming more intelligent than human beings. And that's definitely what we see happening in this book. And we see different takes on humans' opinions about it, like some people not wanting robots in their lives at all, and then some people relying on them. And because I'm sure if you've seen the movie or heard of this, you've heard of the three laws of robotics and what happens if you remove one of those laws. So this is just, it's a pretty short book, so I don't want to say too much. I think my biggest criticism with Isaac Asimov's writing style in general, from everything I've experienced so far and definitely happened in this book as well, is his transitions from like one event or time to another, or even just like separate things. They don't transition well, in my opinion, and I find it less engaging and harder to follow along with such abrupt changes. But overall, I really enjoyed this story and I'm so glad I listened to it. And if you have seen my TBR for September, you know I want to listen to Caves of Steel this month, which I believe is the first book in his robot series. So I definitely loved it enough to continue on with it. Next we have Heart-Shaped Box by Joe Hill, which is a horror novel. And this is the first book I've read by Joe Hill and I was pleasantly surprised. I gave this a 4 out of 5 stars as well. This book starts out, and I was a little unsure of it to begin with because of the way that it begins, and our main character sees a ghost for sale online and he purchases it. And when he receives the ghost, it's a suit in a box, and this spirit is out for vengeance, and it's a ride from there. So while in my opinion the overall plot was maybe a little bit silly and didn't feel like the stakes were super high, the things that I loved about this book were Joe Hill's writing style, the atmosphere, and the dark, gritty, messed up characters. This was just a no good town full of no good people and their terrible pasts and all the things they've done. And it so much made up for how I didn't love the plot and the idea of this actual ghost. But in saying that, like, there were times that I found this story very creepy with the ghost and just the imagery that I could totally picture the ghost in these creepy settings haunting these people and wanting to get vengeance. So definitely his descriptions were excellent in making you kind of get that spine shiver that I'm always looking for when I'm reading my horror books. But in addition to that just like eerie feel, there's a lot of gross things described. I find that most of the disturbing things were events that have taken place in the character's past. And so it's kind of, I don't know if it would be technically set told in like flashbacks, but as we go along, we uncover all of these things about the character's past. And I really enjoyed that storytelling format where we're learning about everything that has happened. And just the people, it's just dark and gritty. It gives me the same feelings that Dark Places and Sharp Objects gave me by Gillian Flynn, where it's just like dirty, nasty people. And like, I don't mean that in an offensive way, but you know what I'm talking about. And if you like that vibe and that feeling like I do, then you'll enjoy this book, because when I'm thinking of horror, like that's more the vibe I'm looking for rather than like jump scares. I just want this like dark, gritty people who have had messed up pasts and now that they're dealing with them. But I liked the character development that we saw, and I did enjoy the way that the book ended, even though in my opinion, it ended a little too happily ever after. That's not spoiling anything. You guys know I love a good tragedy, so I would have brought a little more tragedy into this horror novel at the end if it were up to me. But overall, I'm really impressed with Joe Hill's writing in this book. I really enjoyed this story. I cannot wait to read more by him. And I'm definitely going to be picking up Nosferatu in December. I don't know if I'll get to any more of his works before then, but I'm really excited to pick that up in December. Next, we have The Child Thief by Brum. I give this a 4.5 out of 5 stars. I really enjoyed this. This is a fantasy horror, but I still categorized it under the horror genre, just because I feel like it fits into that. So I don't want to just say that this is a Peter Pan retelling, because Brahm has gone to such lengths to make this story his own that it wouldn't be doing him justice to just say this is a Peter Pan retelling, because it's not. And it's so different and unique in so many ways. And this is why it's so important to like read the acknowledgments in a book sometimes, because he goes into great detail about where he pulled all of his inspirations from. And it's definitely way more than just Peter Pan. And it worked just fantastically, in my opinion. I loved it. I loved every second of this. This is another audiobook as well, which I should have mentioned. I listened to Heart Shaped Box. So everything's been audiobooks so far. We start the book off with meeting Peter, and he's sort of saving this girl from a sexual assault scene. And so you instantly get this feeling like Peter's a good guy helping these children out. And then that's just in the prologue, so it's not spoiling anything. But once we get into the first couple chapters, and he's sort of taking this kid out of a bad situation again, where he's has such a hard life, and Peter is, with their consent, bringing them to his secret island full of adventure and where they're never going to grow old, because the children that he chooses are just so beat down and life has just been so cruel to them that they are ready to risk anything. And even if that means believing in magic to get there and get away from the situation that they're in. Once Nick, the kid who's rescued, gets to this island, that's when the horror scenes come into play. And they are so well done. You guys know by now, well, if you've watched any of my vlogs, that at this point, two books in, I'm a diehard Brahm fan. That man just is a master of what he does, in my opinion. If you guys don't agree, whatever, I don't care. As I mentioned before, because Brahm is an artist as well, I think that's why he's so great at giving us such vivid imagery of what's going on and making the atmosphere like tangible. You feel like you're in this setting, and it's so dark and mysterious and creepy and just horrific, basically. It's like everything that I want in a horror novel. And I love every second of it. So anyways, Nick sees what's going on and he's like, what have I done? Why am I here? Why have I gotten myself into this? And he quickly learns that he's been recruited to fight among the devils, which is a savage tribe of stolen children, to fight in this war that's lasted for centuries. In the midst of all this, we get Peter's past, his backstory. We get so much history of how the island developed and how all of the gods and the lore and the history, it's just so big and expansive for this 450 page novel that I feel like there was nothing left out, but there was also no filler or fluff. It was like just the perfect amount, in my opinion, to make you so engaged, to make you care, to feel like you didn't have any missing pieces, that you got all of the history you needed of these gods and their children and Peter's backstory and the war that they're fighting. And it's definitely more of a tragedy of a book, which we know appeals to me. That's why I liked this one better than the other horror I read, but it was just so well done. It's so like, if you can say a horror book is whimsical, this is it. If you like fantasy and you like horror, I highly recommend this. This is the best version of Peter I've ever seen in my life. The way that Brahm captures him is just absolutely perfect, in my opinion. And if you do read the acknowledgments, which I recommend, there's a line from the original source material that stuck out to him, and that's what he created this Peter to be and this world to be. And if you can't tell, and I'll shut up now, but I just love this book so much, and I can't wait to read more from Brahm. Once again, what is it called? I think it's called Krampus. Definitely picking that up in December, so... I feel like people like to read like romance, sweet, happy books in December, and I'm filling my TBR with Nosferatu and Krampus, which are like horror Christmas books. It's fine. It's fine. That's the life I live. And it's also my birthday month, so it'll be perfect. The next book I read is Empire of Gold by S.A. Chakraborty, which is book 3 in the Devabad trilogy. So this was the conclusion that I read this month. I give this a 4.75 out of 5 stars, which for me is being a tad bit generous, but it's a really, really good conclusion to the series, in my opinion. So in our first book, we're following Nari, our main character, who's a thief and a con artist in Cairo, Egypt, and she makes a living by deceiving people. One day, she actually summons a djinn because she doesn't know that she can actually do that, and is taken on this journey to a whole new world where she didn't know that any of these things or beings or magic, all of the above, existed. And so she has to learn how to adjust to that. There's so much more to this series though than that, and I want to emphasize that it deals with like a lot of different tribes within this kingdom who have been oppressed for a long time. So there's so much warring going on between the different tribes throughout this whole novel. It's very political, and at the same time, you're slowly uncovering all the history of the gods and the people who are in power now versus the people who took power from them. So it is a really complex political system in this kingdom. So that's why I'm not sure this is a perfect book for beginners, but it's not super challenging to follow along with. Everything else is just like super great for new to fantasy readers, which are all the other aspects I loved about this novel as well. But I will just briefly give my thoughts on this. I talked about it a lot in one of my reading blogs that I will link above so that I'm not being redundant, but I think that this book out of all three had the best, most engaging plot in my opinion, the one that I enjoyed the very most. Like I said, everything felt like it was there for a purpose. I didn't feel like there were any scenes that were just thrown in to drag things out or make it longer. Nothing made me question like, why are we doing this right now? Which I feel like happens a lot in books that are not quite 5 stars. So the plot was really great. And like I said, in this book in particular, we learned so much about the history and the past of this world, which I really enjoyed. And we get a lot more development between character relationships, which was great. Once again, her writing is just beautiful. You can fully picture what's going on. And the thing about this series is I'm unfamiliar with the mythology, so I found myself having to Google and look up a lot of the terms for the different beings in this book, which I enjoyed because it is like somewhat of a learning experience, which I think is really important. But then it just made all the difference once I did that because I could see things so much more clearly. And it was just fantastic what she was describing in some of the battle scenes and with some of the creatures that we're encountering. I loved all of it, and it was very unique. I have not read a book inspired by this type of mythology that I've enjoyed so much. My only criticism and why it's not a 5-star book is I didn't care about the characters. Not even a little bit. I didn't care. And I think that's somewhat of an unpopular opinion. When I said that in my vlog, there were a lot of you who agreed with me. But what I generally seem to see is that people would die for these characters, my sister included. She loves these characters so much. So don't let that deter you. I think that it's really hit or miss. It could be either way. But this is a really great series, unique mythology, dealing with religion, dealing with racial ties, dealing with familial relationships. And it's just an excellent, complex story that was a really great conclusion to the trilogy, and I'm so happy I read it. Next we have The Light of All That Falls, which is book 3 in the Lycanius trilogy, so it's a concluding novel as well. And once again, I gave this a 4.75 out of 5 stars. I don't know what stopped it from being a 5-star book for me. It just didn't give me that 5-star feeling, and I did round it up to a 5 stars on Goodreads just because that's what my gut told me to do instead of rounding down, but I'm gonna leave it here as a 4.75. I'm not gonna do a spoiler review for this, and I can't say that much in this wrap up because it would spoil things. I've talked about this so much, so I'm not gonna get into it that much, but this is an excellent series, you guys, that too many people are sleeping on. It gets so complex by the end. The setup and the plot is so intricately thought out that everything is there for a purpose all along, things that you don't necessarily see as being set up. And that's what I loved about book 3, is so many reveals and revelations that the characters are getting, and you're seeing them realize things for the first time of scenes that you've seen before, because this book does deal with time travel in a way, and that's something I'm not usually a huge fan of, but I love it in this series. So I grew to care for these characters so much by the last book that I was so invested in them. The magic, in my opinion, is pretty unique in this book. And I don't think it's super magic heavy, but with the world building and the different types of creatures within this world, I just think it was really well done in something that's not seen done all the time. This story definitely deals with like a good versus evil, and the thing that does it for me is you don't know who to trust, you don't know who's good, and you don't know who's evil. And that's why I love it. That's what I find so fascinating about it. Yeah, this is one of the best conclusions to a trilogy that I have read in a long time, I feel like. And I feel like this will be a series I revisit and will want to reread in the future, because it's one that There's so much jam-packed into it in the details. There's not like fluff and filler that shouldn't be there, but there are so many details in this story that was brilliant in the way that it was done, but you can't necessarily pick up on all of them the first time through. So I feel like I would gain so much by reading this a second time and seeing all the little things that I didn't pick up on the first time. So if there's one fantasy book from this list that you should pick up, it's this one. Please give it a try. Next, we have the book I haven't finished yet, and that is The Fires of Heaven by Robert Jordan, book 5 in the Wheel of Time series. So I have given this a 4.75 out of 5 stars right now. I'm about 85% of the way through it. So basically all I have left to get to is whatever epic things are going to happen at the end of this book. And I have a feeling that could make or break it. It might make it a 5-star or it might make it a 4.5 star. I don't really know, but I felt like 4.75 was pretty fair to settle on for right now. And that's sort of surprising to me because as of right now, not too much has happened. Not a lot is going on as far as events that are taking place. We're sort of just following our separate groups of characters, living their day-to-day life, trying to get where they're going, trying to stay alive, but I love it. I love these slower moments with our characters as we're just getting more character development and watching their relationships evolve with one another. We get more world building and history in this book, and it's just really, really a fun time to me to just spend these moments with our characters in a little bit more of downtime. One thing that I've really recognized by this book, it hasn't taken me 5 books to notice this, but that's just how I feel right now. It stands out so much in this book, and that is Robert Jordan's humor. I love it so much. I laugh all the time in this book at little things that are not over the top. They're just subtle hints of humor that I think work perfect in my opinion, and they always make me laugh. It's not trying hard, it's not over the top. It works just right, and it's sort of like silly humor. I think one of my favorite parts about this book as well is getting to learn more about the Aiel and spending more time with that group. When I come back in my next life, that's who I would like to be part of, that group. They're just the best, man. They are the freaking best. So it feels weird to include a book in my wrap-up that I haven't finished reading yet. Like I said, I have 15% left. I'm going to finish that tonight or tomorrow morning, and today is the 30th. So I have until, if I finish it tomorrow, I'm still finishing it in the month of August. It'll be done before September, and I have enough confidence in Robert Jordan that it's definitely not going to be lower than a 4.5. So I wanted to include it, and I'm not giving many details here because you guys know I do my spoiler-filled book chats for Wheel of Time books. It's not so much a review, it's more of like word vomit of all of my thoughts, of the notes that I'm taking while I'm reading the book. So I will link that above, so that way if you're watching this in the future, you can check that out. If not, just keep an eye out for it on my channel. I'll definitely be filming it as soon as possible once I finish the book, and so it'll be up very shortly. And that leads us to my very favorite book of the month, and that is The Girl with the Dragon Tattoo by Stieg Larsson. I didn't know what this book was going to do to me. I'm so glad it came into my life. I'm so glad I picked it up. 5 out of 5 stars, a new favorite book of all time, a new favorite female character of all time. This book will just mess you up and you'll become so obsessed. I feel like most of you guys have probably heard of this or seen the movie, but I was actually pretty shocked in my reading vlog by the number of you guys who have not read this book yet. And so many of you were like, oh, if you really like it that much, should I pick it up? Girl, guy, friend, pick it up. You need this in your life. It's not for everyone in more than one way. The first being, I've heard a lot of people that don't like the writing style or think that it's slower and it being translated harder to get through. So if you start reading it and that's how you feel, I don't know, I can't relate. I thought it was perfect, but I've heard that complaint several times. The other thing is the content in this book is very graphic and very disturbing, and it's not the whole entire book. So it's not just a book filled with disturbing content, but there are some hard scenes to get through. And if you do read this, I highly recommend watching the US film adaptation because it was phenomenal as well. And that will forever be how I see Lisbeth in my mind now. Okay, so this book, first of all, it's set in Sweden. It's freezing. The atmosphere is just, once again, one where you feel like you're there. Everything is described. I actually got cold while I was reading this book, which is not hard if you know me, because I'm cold 100% of the time, but this made it worse because of his descriptions. And he's so great at creating this atmosphere where you feel like you're there with the characters. So that's the first thing that I loved about this book. But I also loved the slow-paced writing style where you just, get to know these characters very gradually, but it's done so well. And the way that we flash back and forth and these two stories are woven together. And I remember thinking in the beginning, like, what are we doing? How are these connecting? Why are we here? What's going on? But have faith, because he will not lead you astray and you will end up loving it. I'm 99% sure. But back to what I was saying, there's this girl from this really important family who goes missing over 40 years ago. And her uncle hires one of our main characters, Mikkel, to help solve this mystery of what happened to her. And Mikkel is a journalist. There's kind of this separate story going on with him at the same time, where he's being scrutinized for an investigation that he was doing that involved some corruption with money. But anyways, the uncle of this girl hires Mikkel to help solve the mystery. That's the main point of the book, is uncovering the mystery that would happen. But there's also the side plot of Mikkel's investigation that's happening. And then there's Lisbeth. My heart, this girl, I've never felt more heartbroken between the book and the movie. Like, I just could literally die for her, because her character is so well done and so realistic, but she's also like one of a kind. She is a special type of human being, and the way that the author described her, it wasn't over the top. It felt so organic and natural to who she is, especially from everything she's been through in her past. And I'm being so vague on purpose, because I think you should uncover it for yourself. I don't know. I cannot see myself falling in love with a character as much as her anytime soon again, because she was just the best. So she comes into the story by aiding Mikkel, and together they work to solve this mystery. And it becomes about so much family drama as well. When I hear that, I like immediately eye roll and I'm like, that book's not for me. But I promise you, it's so intriguing and it's so well done. This family that's so important but has so many dark secrets in the middle of a possible murder mystery. And then our main two characters are so gripping. I'm gonna shut up now, because I am just going to talk nonstop about how much I love this book, but I already want to reread it, but I need to finish the other two in the first trilogy first before I do that. But yeah, if you were questioning whether to pick this book up or not, pick it up. Just make sure that if you need any kind of content warning, make sure you look that up first. So that was absolutely my favorite book of the month, a new favorite book of all time. And those were the 8 things that I had read in the month of August. As you can tell, I really loved everything I read. Let me know in the comments what your favorite book that I read this month was. Are you planning on picking up any of these books? Now, I read a lot of sequels this month, so let me know if you're planning on starting any of those series after hearing more about it. And let me know if you're gonna watch my Wheel of Time book chat, the spoiler-filled one for Fires of Heaven, because I haven't filmed it yet, obviously, since I'm not finished. I would love to chat with you guys more about these books in the comments. So thank you guys for watching, and I will see you next time.